So here for the Footie Show with Mark Brailsford for a Christmas special. We're going to talk a bit about the games over the festive period, but more about a bit of nostalgia to go back a few years, aren't we? What does Christmas football mean to you as an Albion fan, Mark?
Pain. but delicious pain, you know. It's thick and thin with the Albion, you know, through the ups and downs, you watch them. And actually, Boxing Day games have always produced those surprises that tend to make them special for all sorts of reasons.
Yeah, exactly. And we're going to go back to some of the games that you've been to. I mean, obviously, we'll start off with the Palace game, which I don't think you're at. But I mean, obviously, the whole rivalry of Palace started over a Boxing Day.
Well, it depends which Palace game you mean. Right. I have been to a Palace game Boxing Day, but it wasn't the penalties one. I think it might have been the one that we sing about.
Yeah.
But I was a bit young to know what was going on. So I think it was best avoided to talk about the violence of it. But it was pretty brutal. But I do remember some fantastic Boxing Day games. And inevitably, we used to play Palace a lot on Boxing Day. And it's a shame in a way we don't play them now. I think it'd be quite interesting.
Yeah, exactly. So maybe some of the games, what are the ones that stand out for you on Boxing Day?
Well, I used to love... you used to go to a game like... there was a game against Birmingham on Boxing Day, and Kevin Bremner was playing up front with Gary Nelson. Great. They became this great party. I loved Gary Nelson as well. And Kevin Bremner, bless him, he couldn't do anything right. He was always falling on his backside, you know, couldn't score for Toffee. And then suddenly, he turned into this world-beating international... quality player. He got a hat trick against Birmingham, I think he got a hat trick.
Yeah.
And he was playing against his brother, Des Bremner, for Birmingham, I think. Anyway, but Kevin Bremner up to then, he was like, oh God, it was like painful. And then suddenly he scores all these goals. His confidence soars, which perhaps is a lesson for us now. And then you could stop him scoring for the rest of the season. It was an amazing season. And I loved it. And of course, you know, a lot of people would go to Boxing Day games that would never go to other games.
Yeah.
Like my best mate's girlfriend, that would be the only game she'd go to. It would be one of the few games my brother, my dad and my mate Richard would go to. And all together, it was just amazing as an occasion. We'd had a drink. It was fun. It was festive. Christmas Slade music on the PA shouting, it's Christmas! You know, yeah. And then this bonkers football match that usually went against form.
Yeah, exactly. You do get surprise results on Boxing Day, don't you? Because obviously some of the players not quite up to speed, maybe. Maybe they have kind of had a bit too much, too many shandies.
Yeah,
but, I mean, you do get surprise results, don't you? It can turn someone's team season as well, as you say. It can completely turn it on its head if you get the right result.
Yes, if we get the right result. They're watching the Albion at the moment. You just wouldn't put money on it, would you? But, yeah, exactly. So you're right. And that settles it down in the league as well. I mean, they say about the Premier League at the moment, generally, the top six, certainly, that will shake down the real possible title winners this time.
Yeah.
And it's tight and close and it's really interesting to watch, but although we're at the wrong end of it. But hopefully, you know, with a few decent results, you can turn it round now. And if you don't by now, then you start to get panic.
Yeah, exactly. And you're in after the new year, you're into that big long run up to the end of the season. I mean, Sheffield United at one point, can we discount them yet? Or is it just after 12 games, it's too... No?
It's the Albion. Just never know. it's just you just fear for us at the moment because the lack of confidence, but a couple of victories changes it, you know. But and they just need to score some goals. And I think not signing a striker at the beginning of the season is looking more, by every single game, is looking more and more a mistake.
Yeah.
So it's been hard, isn't it, the last few weeks? But, you know, fingers crossed, you know, it's still halfway through the season.
Yeah, and the weather's good. Have you ever gone to a football game over the festive period in the snow? I mean, I don't remember going to one. I've
Orange
had cold weather.
The works.
Cold weather, but just when's snowy Goldstone?
70s, yeah, definitely in the 70s. And I think it wasn't just because it was snow, it's because it was ice. That was the dodgy bit. But now they would never play it because they would never allow it on health and safety grounds. But, you know, the East Terrace then was like a ice rink, you know. And it was open and frost-covered, and they cleared it. But obviously people had gone in there with shovels, but it was the proper old orange ball, and, you know, people were sliding over the place on the pitch, you know. And it was brilliant football. It was just amazing, and you just loved it because, you know, the weather when everybody's sort of sat down being quiet, you were going out and watching the game and watching the Albion in the good old days as well. You know, the 70s teams were amazing side.
Yeah, exactly. And it's what's weird about the Christmas fixtures, it's always a local team, is it? So it's normally Bournemouth. I mean, that we often come against Bournemouth. It's Bournemouth, it's West Recently, it's been West Ham or Arsenal, of course.
Yeah,
hasn't
of course.
It?
So London team will look more sides. Local.
Yeah.
I mean, in a way, that's quite a shame. It's not Palace, but the police probably have put a little thing into the algorithm
thinking about that.
To announce, to not have it. So yeah. They don't have Palace on Boxing Day.
Yeah, exactly. What about some of the other fixtures you've been to then?
But I mean, my earliest memory of a Boxing Day game was, I think, in the 70s, but it's a bit far. I was quite little. I know I'm old, but I'm not that old to be that memorable. It's not that memorable. But there was a game, and I think it might have been like a Norwich or a Leeds game or Bristol City, but really, we were struggling, you know. And the game was awful. I mean, something like 0-0, and it was terrible, and it was just depressing. So a bit like now, really.
Yeah. We have been to a game which we both attended. So that's my first ever Brighton game. That's Barnet at home.
Yes.
1994. Yes. Yeah. And remember that well. Ian Chapman penalty.
Chapman,
for me, it's my first football game. I loved it. But the game, I just remember the game itself being absolutely dire. It was like we were both at the. I think Barnet were bottom. I think they'd just come up actually from the conference.
Been. Yeah, they just got in.
The season before just got in. Yeah. And so it was just absolutely dire. But somehow we won it. And, you know. It's
well, Brady was manager there, wasn't he? And my dad, I remember, we used to stand behind the dugouts in the West Terrace, stand down there. And my dad was a bit tired that day, and he wanted to shout out to Brady, give them some chip or give them some verbal. He had both words in his head. And then he shouts out at the top of his voice over this silent moment. You know, when a crowd suddenly goes silent, you can hear one voice. And he shouted out, he's trying to say jip or verbal and got them mixed up. And he said, "Oi, Brady, give him some gerbil." It's absolutely true. And it became actually used. Paul Hodgson and Dave Blake, when they wrote Brighton Till I Die, which I was in, my favourite theatre job was brilliant. They named one of the characters Gerbil because of that story. Which was fantastic. Give him some gerbil. I've never let him forget it.
Yeah, so that's... what Amex? Do you think there's a big difference between the Amex, having a festive game at the Amex, and the Goldstone? Goldstone's a bit more nostalgia.
Yeah, the rough and ready.
The rough and ready. I mean...
Yeah, it's easy to get to as well for a start. Transport, you know, Boxing Day. But
yeah, exactly. That's one change, isn't it, to the Amex? What's all that about? I mean...
Privatisation, that's what that's
yeah,
about.
Yeah.
Because those days it wasn't a privatised system.
No.
So you had a train.
Yeah.
And anyway, it's politics, but what you do, there's not much you can do. But you have to just go with it. And it would have been lovely to have the stadium in the centre of town or in where it was, as we talked about. But I think it's a shame that. But I think we've lost something of that atmosphere, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. What about the fixtures? Arsenal, how do you see this game panning out, some of these fixtures? We've beaten them the last two games.
Put it this way, I'm not much of a betting man, but if I was, I wouldn't be betting on an Albion victory at the moment. Although that's one team you really think, we've done them so many times recently, this could be it.
Yes.
Another one.
Yeah, it could be. I mean, that'd be nice, wouldn't
it? Yeah, they're having a rough time, so you never know.
Yeah, another good team where West Ham away is normally where it produces goals.
Yeah,
I mean, we've had two free-frees in a row, haven't we, away? So
Moyes has done a good job there. He's doing really well. And, you know, if Antonio's playing and he's fit, he's a good player. They've got a couple of really good players. Rice is still there. And you've got...
Got Haller as well, but he doesn't seem to hit the back of the net, does he?
But they've got a few good players there now. And they're organised as well, the old cheese, you know, cliche goes. West Ham's a tough one, I reckon.
Yeah. I mean, is there any hope over the festive period, do you think?
No.
I mean...
None whatsoever. It's been a tough year all round for everyone, obviously, joking aside. But it doesn't help when things are, you know, the things you hope cheer you up don't at the moment, do they, when you're actually helping? But, you know, it's been a tough one. You just hope that...
Well, back to scoring.
You've got to, hopefully they'll keep working at it. And they just need a bit of confidence, really, by the look of it.
Yeah.
And they don't seem to have that little kick on that will just produce that confidence. And I think, you know, a bit of confidence and a couple of wins is all you need. And then, you know, you're on a bit of a run and then before you know it, you hopefully...
I put it down to the Man United game at home where the decision went to get... They were brilliant that game. We should have beaten United.
Yeah.
And for me, that I put it down to that
good point.
That penalty Fernandez scored, you know, outside of regulation
time.
Well,
hit the woodwork five times as
well. Yeah, I mean, did Trossard.
Right.
Well, he hit the... Well, he hit all three parts of the goal, didn't he, basically? Yeah. All three posts.
Crossbar challenge.
Crossbar and two posts. I mean, for me, that was a key moment. And then obviously, it could have been a draw, should have been a draw, perhaps. It was a penalty, to be fair. But, playing basketball, wouldn't he, there in the box?
Well, but you go back to VAR there, and I think it's one thing that has been a blight.
Well, we'll discuss it second half, yeah.
Oh, it's VAR, that can do one.
Exactly. So, I mean, we'll talk about that. I mean, VAR, I mean, some of it's gone for us, some of it against us. Mm. I mean, Southampton, I mean, was that a penalty, do you think?
Well, I don't know what's a penalty anymore. If the players and the managers don't know, who am I to know? I don't know. I'm convinced that it was worse. It's worse having this now than the bad decisions that used to go against us. It would even out over a season generally, but this doesn't. I don't think.
Yeah, and I know you've been to some non-league games as well, and there's a big difference, isn't there, when you get the dodgy decisions either. Well, I guess it evens itself out if you have VAR or not over the season. Is that right, do you think? Or
piece of string and bias, isn't it? I mean, obviously, I'm bound to say when you're on the wrong end of a decision, you'll think, oh, blame VAR, and then you're right. We had a few games go our way because of it. But I would rather it not go for or against us. I don't care it went for us. It's still wrong.
Yep.
The principle of the system is wrong.
Discuss more about that with Mark Brailsford in the second half on the Treason Show, of course. So we're going to have a special Christmas Treason Show as well as the Footie Show, and we're going to have the second half of the Footie Show shortly. So back here for the Christmas special Footie Show with Mark Brailsford from the Treason Show, and we're going to be talking a bit more about VAR. I know you've got to be in your bonnet. Got to be in your bonnet about it. I think most fans have. I mean, some games are just ludicrously delayed through a VAR decision, aren't they? It just takes forever. I mean, the second goal against the Albion, actually, Southampton, that was a long wait for that, and I was at the Amex.
The problem with it. How long does it take? And also, at the moment, there are no fans really in the grounds, except for a few of them because of COVID. But, you know, when you're in the ground watching the game, and you go, can I celebrate a goal? I hate that. That is not the football I fell in love with when I was a kid, and it's not the game that really appeals to fans in the stadium as much now. And I think that they're going to lose people. I started to watch non-league games recently because there were no other ways to see football, and I had a much better experience. And it's wonderful. It's more rough and ready. You're close to the ground. You can have a drink. And it's blood and thunder football. There are a few dodgy decisions, but very few really that bad. And nowhere near as perhaps the same as VAR's controversy. And it was just more honest, I think, and less corporate, and a lot more genuine.
Yeah.
And I think I preferred that. And VAR is turning it into someone judging the game who sat in a TV studio room 50 miles away. I mean, that's not the football match I fell in love with.
No. So would you do away with VAR?
Totally.
Or would you just leave it for some red card decisions even, maybe?
Nope. Get rid of it. Totally.
Wow.
Get rid of it. Because there always were other options. They should have used more of the... For example, a referee can go over and confer with his referee's assistant, as they call the linesman now. And that used to bug me with a game before VAR, that they wouldn't do that more often. They would rely on their team of people to work together with it. And if they did that, they would have come to better decisions. But there was this kind of, no, the referee's view is fine, or he won't ask the linesman. Even now they've got the communication device. They should have relied on that more. They should have tried that more. They should have used... definitely keep the goal... the goal line technology, because that's almost impossible to improve on. Because you know when a ball's crossed.
Sheffield United fan.
Well, there was that game, yeah.
But
that
Villa stayed up by 1 point.
Yeah, which you're right. Which again shows you the limits of technology. Even the reliable stuff can be unreliable. So what does that say about VAR? Which is not reliable and still human error based on someone who's not even in the ground.
Yeah.
I think on a moral point, on a principle point, I think I object to it on those levels.
Yeah. I think we're still going to see it though. Because, did it not come in through the when we the Germany-England game, obviously, when there was a goal
Lampard.
That was the Lampard. I mean, that's when really Sepp Blatter, well, I mean, where's he now, by the way? But Sepp Blatter said, well, we need to introduce technology because that was clearly a goal. I mean, it's what.
But they did, and that's goal line technology that works.
Yeah.
So that's okay.
Yeah.
It's like Hawkeye now.
You're right.
Example.
Yeah.
But this is the VAR has taken that logic to its illogical extension, and it's exceedingly stupid because it's not based on the sportsmanship level. Football can be a bit unsporting at times, let's face it, but it's not based on the justice of the game on the day and the presence of the people in that ground at that time. And I think that betrays a principle of the game.
Yeah, and then, I mean, it's these handball decisions as well. I mean, there's a lot going on there, isn't there? Where, I mean, you know, Welbeck got kicked on the foot. I mean, was that a penalty? So we have had stuff go for us in the against us. But I mean, I think it's a delay in the game, which is the major point. Goal line technology, though, you're saying it's here to stay, right?
I think that's makes all right. sense. That makes sense because it's clean and clear.
Yeah. Yeah, it is,
But referees are also being turned into robots. And I feel a bit for the refs, actually, because the last really controversial decision, when the penalty went against us against Southampton, the referee actually made the right decision, to the point where the professional game board actually then admitted after the match, a few days later, that it was a mistake for VAR to then rule it to be a penalty. The ref himself was certain. He went, that's outside the box, and it was. So the ref was right. Yeah. And I think we've got to trust the refs. I mean, it's hard enough to referee a game, I'm sure, these days.
But we probably would have got a point. I mean, Southampton were good that second half, but you can imagine Brighton hanging on.
Yeah.
So that might be a point we need at the end of the season. I know you've got a show coming up. Tell us about the Footie show, because we always like your football shows. What's this going to include?
We did this this time last year at Whitehawk. Great place to go and watch a bit of non-league football.
Yeah.
And Paul Hodgson wrote this play with... this guy called Chris, who we work with a lot, and it was funny. Oh, it's funny. And it's a play about a fictional football team in an Eastern European country called FK Kalk. And these three fans of this football team from a mountaintop come support Whitehawk. And the play was about, it's actually quite a serious one, but it's quite a funny play. And it was a tryout to try and get applications for funding, blah, 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 which has now happened, and the funding going to hopefully fall into place, and we'll be hopefully, subject to COVID, touring that play in the autumn this next year now. But anyway, the tryout night was to 20 minutes of the play that was rehearsed in, and three of us did it, and the crowd didn't know that it was a football play. They just thought there was these three crazy idiots from Eastern Europe who'd come to support Whitehawk, which probably wasn't helped by the fact that a few people recognised me because of the Treason Show, but that's fine. But what was lovely about it was for the food bank charity over in Whitehawk, and it raised some money for them that night, and I thought that was brilliant. And JJ Waller did his photo montage and stuff of Whitehawk, which was fantastic. Attila did some fantastic stuff, and there was Eddie Brimson, the comedian, on who was very funny, and Paul Hodgson, just brilliant writer. I mean, what a writer. And it was a pleasure to do that play, and we did Brighton Till I Die, and so I love working with Paul on football stuff. And yeah, next year we'll be touring non-league football clubs with a play.
Right, and so do we have to? I mean, that could be. We don't know where we're going to be. Should we not even go there?
Probably not.
But it can always. You've probably prepared for all eventualities. It could be. Yeah.
Who knows, Mark? Who knows? I mean, Treason Show, for example. I mean, we're now on telly, which is great. You know.
Yeah.
But live shows is where. You know, we have our bread and butter, and I just miss it live. You know, and but who knows? Hopefully, we'll be back. In the spring, in maybe the summer, but the Treason Christmas special was though is on latest TV. Though.
Yeah, it is.
To see that.
Yeah, exactly. And I've seen your Joe Biden now as well, which is great. Yeah, I mean, fantastic. Yeah,
he's fun.
Yeah, exactly. And we'll be saying goodbye to Trump pretty soon. Are you going to carry on with Trump because he's still going to be around, isn't he?
God, I hope not.
On the political, he'll still be in the political scene. He seems to be gearing up for another run. If he can get away with it,
only because he's in debt and he's trying to avoid prison. I think what will happen is, he'll try and cling on there.
Yeah.
And he could be valued, but I'd be quite happy. I've played him long enough.
Yeah.
It's not so great anymore. Not great. Not doing it bigly.
What else? I mean, what else can we look forward to in the Treason Show then in 2021? I mean, I know you've got a new character, the vaccination thing.
Anti-vax.
Anti-vax, yeah.
Oh, with all your problems and conundrums. Hello. It's all the Illuminati. Anyway, she's bonkers. I love that character.
Yeah.
Because since we started off the TV show, we got some new writers join the team, and they'd be coming up with some lovely stuff, and it really bodes well now for the future of the live shows as well. We're going to have new writers on that. And we've got some lovely new characters. And anti-vax is the lovely one.
Yeah, exactly. But by then, of course, the vaccination programme would have been rolled out. So, I mean, we're probably going to be talking about COVID for a long time. Mm. So, I mean, there's going to be a lot of material there, isn't there? But Boris well. We've got Boris with Keir Starmer. I mean, Brexit's back. For how long? But also, Brexit's going to be back next year. I mean, it would have happened by then. Good knows.
There's an idea for a song. Brexit's back. God help us, I mean, this is the thing with the Treason Show. I started it 20 years ago, over 20 years ago. And I always thought, I'll run out. You know, we're only going to do it for a few months. That was 20 years ago. And as people probably heard me interviewed, might remember. But now, it's clear. And back then it was not so clear, but it was happening, is that there's always something going on. There's always news. There's always new stories. There's always new characters. There's always new politicians. There's always new famous people. There's always new subjects. And you can't predict what's going to happen. And who would have predicted Trump? Who would have predicted Boris Johnson? Only in magic satire land could you come up with these characters and mad people enough to have this comedy joy. But in a way, we've had it harder because they out-satirise real life. And how do you satirise something so absolutely bonkers like this that we're living through?
And you're increasingly putting stuff to music, aren't you, which I think is brilliant. So, I mean, I love this trucker song for the queues, the convoy theme. Absolutely.
Well, we've hit the button on that because it's going to be like, yeah. you're going to be in a Brexit convoy at Dover and Kent, the toilet of England, not along with the garden.
It's so good, yeah. So, I mean, you can. There's loads. It's a good way of kind of satiring something, isn't it?
It's also bringing back some songs from different eras as well, and also honouring that music. But I mean, they're parody lyrics to old tunes, but people have not heard some of these tunes, and they go, "Oh, that's a good song." Oh, yeah, go back and listen to the original.
Yeah,
you know, it's really good. But I think that it's a nice bit of fun to have a bit of parody, and it's also a British cultural satirical tradition. Yeah. Parody is very important.
Yeah, exactly. And we can get that on, I think you're on Christmas Day and Boxing Day, aren't you, on latest TV? So people can look out for that. And then you're going to be the Christmas show.
We've had a lot of fun with that Christmas show. Yeah. We put a lot into that. And I'm really pleased with that one. And I think you'll enjoy the Christmas show. It sends up Christmas as well as makes you laugh as well.
And back to the football, just before we finish up. I mean, obviously, we'll
do
see.
In
January, we'll just see where we're at in January, I think. I mean, hopefully we pick up a few points over the festive period, and then we'll take a rain check in January. It's probably the
take a reindeer check more like. I think we'll I'm going to brace myself for the Christmas fixtures, put it that way.
Yeah, right. Cheers, Mark. Yeah, take care. Cheers. Happy Christmas.
Happy Christmas to you.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk.